Father, we thank you for this place, Lord. We thank you for yet an opportunity to be here in the house of God, Lord. We don't come for tradition or ritual. We come to hear from you. We don't come to hear from a man or from a woman. We come to hear from the Holy Spirit. We ask tonight your Holy Spirit would teach us, lead us, and guide us. And Lord, we thank you that as we open your word, Lord, these are not just some pages of a historical text, but this is word and this is life for us today. And Lord, I pray that as we open up your word, your Holy Spirit would inspire us, would lead us and guide us and direct us and motivate us to be who and what you've called us to be. And Lord, we thank you for all that you've done for us. Lord, we ask that you'd bless all the churches across the Inland Empire and around the world that are preaching and hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. We thank you for our fellow rock churches around the Inland Empire in Southern California. Bless them tonight, Lord, as we ask that you would bless us and we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' mighty name, we all said,
amen.
Amen. If you would turn with me to the book of 2 Chronicles in the 33rd chapter, 2 Chronicles chapter 33, we're going to talk on a subject tonight that the Bible tells us is very, very important, mandated, required. And the subject I want to talk about over the next couple of weeks is the subject of forgiveness. Subject of forgiveness, and the title of the series, the two parts, is The Power of Forgiveness. And tonight specifically, I want to talk about forgiving yourself. As a parent, it's so much fun to see how God operates, because you really get an image of God and us when you have children. And I think even so, I remember, you know, when Stacey was pregnant with our first child, Bjorn, everybody would tell me, man, you know, your life is going to be different. It's never going to be the same. And I kind of never quite got a hold of what that meant until the very first time I held Bjorn. And instantly, I just felt the overwhelming presence and the love of God on my life. Because in that one moment, although I had never met Bjorn, I didn't know what his personality was, I didn't know what his propensities were going to be, I loved him with an unconditional and an undying love. And I knew at that moment, my life would never be the same. And it's so much fun raising children. It's an adventure, it's a challenge, it's a trial, it has its highs and it has its lows. But I love, if anything else, as a preacher raising children, because man, they give you all sorts of stories to preach about. I remember growing up, my daddy would always talk about me, and I would be in youth or in children's ministry, and then I'd come out and everybody would be like, man, your daddy told us a story about you. And I'm like, Dad, why you gotta talk about me? And it's just so much fun as a parent to talk about that. And I remember a little while ago, Emma, my daughter, she's 3 years old. She just turned 3 in December, and she says way too many words. My wife and I and Bjorn, all 3 of us are heavy introverts. I know people always say, Pastor Luke, I can't believe that you're an introvert. Amen. I want to be home alone all day by myself. Introverts unite at home alone. And so myself, Stacy, and Bjorn, man, we're all introverts. And then there's Emma. And she's just like talkative. She just has too many words for her own know-how. So she's just like, daddy, 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 daddy. And we're like, what? Get it out. And she was playing in the children's ministry, and through no fault of anybody else's but her own, she fell on the carpet. And you know when you fall on the carpet, you get those rug burns. And so she came home, and, you know, her and Bjorn, they're in different classes because they're in different ages. And she came home, and she was like, I got an ouchie. And we're like, oh, no, you know, poor baby, where's your ouchie? And she pulls it up, and she's like, look, there's my ouchie. And she's pointing to her knee, and Bjorn's over there. And, you know, when you're kids, you always want to get attention. And Bjorn's like, well, I got an ouchie, too. We're like, where's your ouchie, Bjorn? And he's like, he pulls it up. He's like, I got a bruise. And we're like, oh, man, that's an ouchie. And Emma's like, you're not going to outdo me. And she's like, Daddy, I got another ouchie. We're like, you have another ouchie. She pulls it up, and she's like, see, I got a little ouchie. And then Bjorn's like, well, I got another ouchie. And so he's rolling up his sleeve, and they're just going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, comparing scars and ouchies. And, you know, maybe you've seen kids do that, and they come in, or maybe you've seen your kids, or you have nieces or nephews or something like that, and they run in, and they're like, look what I got. And we do that. You know, we look at kids, and they like to compare scars. I think even sometimes as adults, we do that. You know, I mean, I've got a couple of scars on my body, and sometimes we get around the guys, and somebody's talking about it. I'm like, oh, yeah, I got a good one, and I got a scar on my shoulder. I'm like, look at this one. That was the first time I ever rode a dirt bike, and I never rode one after that because of this right here. And we begin to compare scars. Why? Because we carry them along our life because they're an experience. things happen to us, and oftentimes they leave a scar, and we carry them around, you know, like scars on our body. Everywhere we go, they're there, and they're always a testament to what happened or to the experience that at the moment or whatever it might have been. And as adults, we carry around these scars in our lives. And oftentimes these scars might be what somebody did to us, what somebody said to us, what somebody, you know, maybe they didn't do for us, and that left a deep wound or a deep scar when we were reaching out to somebody and they never acknowledged that we were in pain or that we needed them or they weren't there when we needed them most or whatever it might be. But oftentimes we carry around these scars, and many of the wounds that we carry are self-inflicted wounds. I look at one of the most prominent scars I have. It's a cut on my hand, and you know, when I was a kid, mom and dad were starting the church. We never had medical insurance, and so I sliced my thumb to the bone. And you know, Pastor Jim, Pastor Deborah, they laid hands on it. Amen. They spoke in tongues. They got a little Pentecostal on it, like be healed. And then they threw some Band-Aids on it, and we just had faith. Amen. It was great. It needed stitches. And whenever I touched that scar, like because it was a deep scar and it never really healed right, and I always get the little heebie-jeebies because I can feel the muscle kind of separate, but it was a self-inflicted wound. And every time I look at that, I remember of the experience. I'll never forget what I did to do that. You know, I was carving something, and my dad told me, you ought to be careful with that knife. And I said, Dad, you know, when you're young, like, I know, right? Like 3 seconds later, whoosh, I'm all right, getting lightheaded from all the blood loss. Sometimes in life we do stupid things. We make mistakes. I mean, I don't know about you, but sometimes in life we just downright sin. Can anybody give me a little bit of a, like, amen, Pastor Luke? Some of y'all sitting here back here like, no, I ain't that way. You ought to read 1 John chapter 1 if you think you don't got none of that sin. Amen. We carry around these scars, and oftentimes it's those scars, they begin to define us, they begin to identify us. When somebody begins to talk about something and it brings up that scar, or it's a reminder of that wound, it's a reminder of that past hurt, it's a reminder of that past mistake, all these emotions, all these memories, all these associations kind of pop back up, and they begin to surface in our area of, you know, well, you did this, or you did that, or you didn't do this, or you said that to your wife, or you were this kind of a parent to your children, or whatever it might be, and these scars begin to identify us, and they weigh us down. They begin to, we associate with them, but you know, your scars might be a part of you, but they are not who you are. And the Bible has a lot to say about forgiveness, and over the next couple of weeks, I want to talk about forgiveness, but before we get into the major subject of talking about forgiving others, I wanted to address forgiving ourselves, because if you're like me, you've made some humdinger mistakes. Maybe they weren't a big deal in the grand scheme of life, but you got regrets. You look back and you say, man, if I just could have done it that way, if I just wouldn't have said that to my wife, if I just would have done that on the job instead of done this, everything else would have been different, and where I'm at today would have been a completely different story. And today, as we talk about the power of forgiveness, I want to look at what the Bible has to say about the power behind forgiveness, because forgiveness is not something that Jesus says you ought to do. Jesus says you must forgive. And so I want to look at that. And when God gives us a command, there's always a power behind that command. And I want to look tonight about the subject of forgiving yourself, of letting go of those wounds, of not letting those scars or those memories or those past mistakes, those past decisions define who you are or inhibit where God wants to take you today. So the question is, what does the Bible say about the subject of forgiving yourself? Do you want to know? Nothing. But instead of looking at a verse that says, you ought to forgive yourself, thus saith the Lord, I want to look at the principles of forgiveness and to understand and to recognize some truths. Because you know what the Bible is full of? The Bible is full of a lot of people that have made mistakes. You know, the Bible, with the exception of Jesus, every other character, think about that. With the exception of Jesus, every other character sinned. Every other character had a regrettable past. Every other character, every other person, every other significant person in history did something that they regretted, that they didn't want to do. Every person had a past. And the Bible talks about their pasts. And the Bible talks about their futures. And we get to look back at that. And so today I want to look at the story of a man who had a very regrettable life, who had a lot of scars, who did a lot of bad things, and what God did for him. So I had you turn to 2 Chronicles in the 33rd chapter. And we're going to look at the story of the son of Hezekiah. Hezekiah is known as one of the greatest kings of Israel, one of the greatest kings of the nation of Israel. And after Hezekiah dies, his son at the age of 12, Manasseh, takes over the leadership of the nation of Israel. And the Bible tells us that Manasseh was one of the worst kings in the history of Israel. And the ironic thing is that he was also the longest reigning king. 55 years on the throne he lived. Josephus, the Jewish historian, talks about Manasseh and talks about every day Manasseh persecuted people who were loyal to God to the point where he killed one person loyal to God every day. That's not in the Bible. That's a Jewish historian writing the account of Jewish history on the outside. And in 2 Chronicles, the 33rd chapter, verse number 1, it says, Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king, and he reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. But he did evil, verse number 2, in the sight of the Lord, according to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. Now, I'll give you a little bit of background of history. God kind of told the people of Israel, they had their chance, and they never followed me. Therefore, I'm casting them out, and I'm giving you their land. You know, sometimes we look at the promised land, and we think, man, God was kind of mean. He kind of just booted everybody out and just kind of like made way for his promised people. But you see, God said, they had their chance, and I chose a man who was faithful and loyal, Abraham, and I gave him a promise to the people who missed out on their opportunity. And here, Manasseh, the son of Hezekiah, the great king of Judah, here Manasseh is one of the worst kings, and it says that he did abominations going all the way back to the people before the promised land, doing the things that they did to get them kicked out of the promised land. And now I'm going to skip down a couple of verses, because in between verse number 2 and verse number 9, it talks about all the different things that Manasseh did that was evil, including building. I mean, you got to be pretty gutsy to do this against God, but he put an altar in the temple of God for his false idols. I mean, that's pretty hefty. But verse number 9, if you jump down on your Bible, look what it says. It says, so Manasseh seduced Judah and its inhabitants. You see, Manasseh wasn't just ignorant. He wasn't just blind. He wasn't just like, oh, you know, I'm only doing what I know. Because sometimes we commit mistakes. Sometimes we make sins out of ignorance. I didn't even recognize, or I didn't even realize that I was doing something wrong until I was done with it. The Bible says here that Manasseh seduced Judah. Manasseh knew what he was doing. He knew what he was saying. He knew the actions that he was going on, or that he was taking on. And so he seduced the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem to do more evil than the nations whom the Lord had destroyed before the children of Israel. This guy had a regrettable life. You might look back at the mistakes. You know, we call them oftentimes, we use the terms, the skeletons in your closet. You might look back at the things that you've done, the things that you've said, maybe the things that you did not do. They might be recent, they might be decades old, but you've got a past, you've got a history, you've got scars. When you look at a man like Manasseh, when the Bible describes him as one of the worst kings of Judah, bringing people, seducing the people of God back to a place that they were more wicked than they were as wicked as the people who God drove out, you can understand and relate that this guy had a past. This guy had made some mistakes. He had made some bad decisions, committed things like murder, abominations, idolatry, all sorts of different wicked things and abominable things in the eyes of God Manasseh was guilty of. And so here in verse number 10, it says, and the Lord spoke to Manasseh and his people, but they would not listen. Sometimes we can relate to that. In the midst of our mistakes, in the midst of our trials, maybe you're caught up in a repetitive sin. Maybe you're caught up in a sin trap where it seems like there's no light at the end of the tunnel. No matter how hard you try, no matter how hard you struggle, it seems like you just can't seem to find your way out of it. And every time you're doing something or every time you're walking into that trap, you can hear the voice of God saying, come on, you can do this. You're better than this. But then you fall into that trap and then you beat yourself up again. God spoke to Manasseh. Manasseh, come on. You're better than this. Your daddy taught you the right ways. Your dad was a good king. Your dad did all the right things. You know better than this. But Manasseh didn't want to listen. It says, therefore, the Lord brought upon them the captains of the army of the king of Assyria, who took Manasseh with hooks and bound him with bronze fetters, bronze chains, and carried him off to Babylon. The imagery here tells us that the king of Babylon literally put a ring through Manasseh's nose and carried him with a chain through his nose to Babylon. A humiliation, brought down, a man full of regrets, a man who lost everything. Well, his nation was conquered under his leadership. And here Manasseh's in the worst season of his life. Oftentimes we think, man, you know, nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Here's a man who in the eyes of God is wicked, who just got taken into captivity with a ring put into his nose. Imagine getting dragged out of your home with a ring put through your nose. The pain involved in that. And so it says that in Manasseh, verse number 12, when he was in affliction, implored of the Lord his God and humbled himself greatly before the God of his fathers. And he prayed to him, speaking of God. And God received his entreaty. He heard his supplication and he brought him back to Jerusalem into his kingdom. And then Manasseh knew that the Lord was God. Think about that for a moment. One of the worst kings in the history of Judah, in the history of Israel, dragged away in captivity in the moment of anguish, in the moment of anxiety, in the moment of heartache, in the moment of the realization of all of the wrongs that he's done, when his life is completely collapsed upon him like a house of cards, he calls out to God, and the Bible says that God heard his entreaty. He heard his pleas. He heard his prayers. He saw and recognized that Manasseh had humbled himself before God. And the Bible says that God restored Manasseh and he brought him back to Jerusalem. And there we'll see in a little bit that Manasseh literally changed his ways. You see, in our lives, we live in the incentive system. We operate in the incentive system. The incentive system is you do good, you'll get rewarded for good. You do bad, you'll get punished for bad. I remember when I was training one of our dogs, we went to one of those dog training things where everybody gets in a circle and the dog trainer tells you what to do with your dog so they don't jump on people and they're really well behaved. I have terribly behaved dogs because like many Christians, we hear the word of God and we hear the wisdom, yet we don't apply it. And the dog trainer says, you know what we like to do is we like to beat our dogs. Amen. You know, you shame your dog. Your dog does something in the house or they do something outside. They chew on something. You beat them and they give you that big old look like, oh, I'm sorry. Just realistically, the dog has no clue what they've done. They don't understand. But they understand incentive. And she said, if you focus on the good for the dog and you give them a treat for everything that they do good, they'll begin to associate everything they do good with a treat. And because they want more treats, they'll do more of what you said is good. And so the dogs are trained with the incentive system. We live on that incentive system. But you know what happens? Is we have a flesh. We have a conscience. We have emotion. And on top of all of these things that we have on our own self, we have the devil, the enemy, Satan. The Bible says the accuser of the brethren who comes and tries to tell us about this incentive system saying, you know what? You've made too many mistakes. That mistake you made, you're an idiot. You're a loser. You're a washout. God, you're not even a Christian because you can't seem to get out of it. You've got too many scars. Who would love somebody that looks like you with the weight of sin and the mistakes that you've made and all the wounds and the pain that you have? The incentive system the devil tries to play on you is the bad, to give up, to let go because you're not worth it. And we have this battle. This argument, this war that rages on the inside of us. Paul the Apostle in Romans, the 7th chapter, says, I see that there's a law at work on the inside of me, that there's this evil flesh that does what it wants to do, but my mind wants to do what God wants, and my body does what it wants to do. And who will save me from this wretched body, he says. He says, thank God for Jesus Christ. Thank God for Jesus Christ. You see, the devil wants to tell you about the incentive system and that you don't deserve the incentive system. And that the things that you've done, the scars all over your body, the self-inflicted wounds that you've put to yourself, the sins that you have committed, maybe even today, disqualify you from the love of God. But let me tell you something. If anything we get out of the story of Manasseh, you are not too far gone for God. You are not too far gone to turn back. If Manasseh could be one of the worst kings of Judah and find in his heart the recognition of his wrongdoings and to cry out to God and to God for to recognize what he did, you and what's going on in your life with the sin, with the scars, with the self-inflicted wounds, you are not too far from God. That he doesn't have a plan for you, but the devil's going to come and try to tell you that you're worthless. It's going to try to tell you that you're no good, that you're beat up, that you're scarred, that you're ugly, that nobody could love somebody as ugly as you because of all of the things that you've done that have given you the look that you have. But God says, no, that is not the truth, that the devil is a bold-faced liar. And God says, I love you. I love you. I love you. I desire you. You are my bride. You are spotless in my eyes because of Jesus Christ. And we've got to learn to not buy in to the incentive system of the devil, but rather to listen to the words of God. And Hebrews, as the author of Hebrews reiterates the book of Jeremiah, that the Bible tells us that the mercies of God are new every morning. And God says to his children, he says, if you follow after me, I will forget your sins. I'll blot them out. Hebrews chapter 10, verse number 17, he says, their sin and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. You see, you are not too far God for God to do something in your life. But it starts with forgiveness. It starts with accepting and walking in the reality of God. You see, forgiving yourself is not letting go of your pain, of your anguish, of all your scars. They are what they are. Forgiving of yourself is walking in the reality that you have been forgiven by God himself. To start forgiving yourself is to walk in the reality that you, despite all of the scars, despite all of the mistakes, despite all of the pain self-inflicted that you have done, all of the stupid things that you've said or the things that you did not do, walking in forgiveness of yourself is walking in the reality that you have been forgiven by God himself through Jesus Christ. It's not a message about self-coddling. Oh, to forgive yourself, you got to pat yourself on the back and tell you how good of a person you are. That's not your job. That's God's job. Our job is to walk in the reality of the forgiveness of Jesus Christ that he paid for on that cross 2,000 years ago when he cried out to God, it is finished. And in that moment, the grace of God came upon you and I to forgive us of our sins. The Bible says in Romans that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. You see, God's not shocked by your life. He wants to take you to another level in your life. And he says, it's time for you to walk in the reality that with the mistakes and the scars that you've put upon yourself, I have forgiven you of them. And when you walk in the forgiveness of God, you begin to walk in the forgiveness of yourself. To let go. To do something beyond holding on, to being held back by what you've done or what you've not done. So the question is, then how do I forgive myself? I want to walk in the forgiveness of God. I want to walk in that reality. What is it, Pastor Luke, that I'm supposed to do? We saw that God can forgive Manasseh. If God can forgive Manasseh, surely God will forgive you. Amen. Forgiveness is open for everybody. How do we do this? I'm just going to give you two things. Talk it out, walk it out. Talk it out, walk it out. It's that easy. What do you do to start forgiving yourself in your life for the scars that you've committed, for the self-inflicted wounds? Talk it out, walk it out. Talk it out with God. Talk it out with God. The Bible talks about having a conversation with God. Jesus Christ talks about Luke and says, I came to suffer on the cross, to raise, and so that in my name, the gospel of repentance and remission of sins would be preached around the world. And we've got to talk it out with God, to not try to harbor all of these scars and all of this weight and all of these things that go that try to hold us back, but rather to begin to give it to God, to go to God. So often we're afraid of talking it out to God. A little while ago, my son Bjorn, since he's the subject of a lot of my stories, my son Bjorn came running in. I mean, hysterical. Him and Emma, they were playing outside, and he came running in, and he's like, "Daddy," and he's crying, his tears are everywhere, and snot and everyone, "Daddy, Emma punched me, and then she bit me." And I'm like, "Emma," you know, like, "Dad," I like to get that dad voice. Every time I talk about dad, when we have our memories of Pastor Jim, we're always dad's. Dad's always like, "Hey, get over here." And dad's like, "I never talked like that." Like, to a kid, you did. So in my dad voice, I'm like, "Emma." So she comes over here, and I'm like, "Did you punch Bjorn and bite him?" "No, Bjorn punched me and bit me." So she's crying, and he's crying, and I'm like, "God, give me the wisdom of Solomon. What can I cut in half to decide who's the right?" So I asked Bjorn, "Where'd Emma bite you?" He's like, "With my arm." And he's pointing to something, it's like just some random spot on his arm. And I'm like, "Don't see anything." "Emma, where did Bjorn bite you?" And she rolls up her sleeve, "Oh, my arm." And there's teeth marks. And I'm like, "Oh." So I'm like, "Bjorn, come here." So I sit down and get in that real serious daddy voice. "Bjorn, tell me the truth." "Emma punched me. Emma hit me." "Bjorn, tell me the truth." "Okay, Dad. I punched her and I bit her." I'm like, why did you come and tell that? Tell me that she, "Because I'm scared." "Are you sorry?" "Yes, Dad, I'm so sorry." "Why are you sorry?" "Because you found out." But you think about it. We think about that for a moment. So often we try to talk it out with God because our life just fell apart. So often we go before God because everything else just collapsed. And now it's time for us to talk it out with God. See, I'm not necessarily sorry. And I don't necessarily feel the weight and the anguish of the scars and the self-afflicted wounds of the things that I've done in the past. I'm bummed because I just got called out on it. So we go before God and we say, "God, I'm sorry." And then the next day we do it again. Paul the Apostle talks about this in a man in the Corinthian church. This guy was jacked up in the head. Amen. Praise God, there were people in the Bible that were jacked up in the head. 2 Corinthians in the 7th chapter, Paul the Apostle talks about it. And he says, godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation, not to be regretted. "I'm sorry, God." And God's like, "Why?" "Because you caught me." That's a regret. But sorrow of the world produces death. You see, we got to talk it out with God, not because our life's fallen apart. We got to talk it out with God because we're recognizing and realizing, you know what? The Spirit of God begins to speak to me. The Bible tells us that one of the roles of the Holy Spirit is to convict the world of sin. That the Holy Spirit loves me enough like a parent loves their child enough to not get away with crap. Can I say that? Can we be real? We're San Bernardino. Nobody cares. He says, godly sorrow produces repentance. You see, repentance is not going to God saying, "God, I want to talk it out. God, I'm sorry. Okay, cool, I'm forgiven. All's good." Repentance is a physical action of changing everything. Dad always used to do the example like this. Repentance is, I'm walking in something that's going to scar me in my life. Sin, shame, mistakes, bad decisions. Repentance is, you know what, God? I recognize and I realize that this is not what you have for me. And I'm not going to go down that path anymore. And repentance is, I'm going to take a 180-degree turn or a 270-degree turn. And God, I'm going to turn. And I'm not just going to go another direction. I'm going to go your direction. And I'm going to walk towards Jesus. And I'm going to go towards the Lord. And I'm going to go towards you. And I'm going to start living in your ways. You see, 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9, people might want to say all they want to say about that. That's not written to the church. You don't got to do that. Whatever. I don't even care. Because the Bible tells us when we confess our sins to God, verse number 9, it says that he's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of them. Which means we got to talk it out. You've got scars that are holding you down, that are trying to identify you. You've got the voice of the devil whispering on you. You're worthless. You're messed up. You're ugly. You've got all sorts of scars all over yourself. But we got to go to God because God says, no, look, that's not a scar. That's a dirt clot. Let me just, come here, baby. Let me just wipe that off for you. We got to talk it out with God. And you know the amazing thing about what God does? God doesn't hang it over your head. I got a speeding ticket when I was in college. The district attorney tried to throw me in jail. I told the story before once. It was a bad speeding ticket. There was no excuse. And he says, you know, I'm going to let you off the hook. But then he says these words. He says, you're on probation. You got a probie. I'm legit. I had a probie officer, all right? I got street cred. He says, you're on probation. If you get so much as a jaywalking ticket in my town, I'm going to throw the book at you for everything. Every day, I'd wake up, look at that red light, like, I'm not going. Us Californians, we look at the yellow light, we're like, that means speed up. No, when you've got a probie officer hanging over your head, that means slam on your brakes and just wait it out. Right turn on red, I ain't gonna risk it. Nope. You're supposed to signal a turn 50 feet, I'm gonna signal a turn 75 feet. Jaywalking? Hey, amen. I'm not going to jaywalk. You see, because you live in fear that you're going to get in trouble again, but God does not do that. Oh, God, I'm so sorry, and I've actually repented, and I've worked it out with you, and now I'm going towards. He's not like, hey, remember when? Hey, remember when? Hey, remember when? As a matter of fact, you remember what we talked about in Hebrews, the 10th chapter? It says, I will remember your sins no more. God's not going to bring up your drama, your scars, when you talk it out with him. But we get afraid. Oh, I'm afraid. I don't want to get caught. I don't want to get called out. We've got to talk it out with God because that's what God wants us to do. Why? Because he loves you. Because you're never too far gone to turn around and talk it out with God. Because forgiving yourself is walking in the reality that you have been forgiven by God himself. Why? Because you've gone to God. Talk it out with God. You got to talk it out with others. Talk it out with others. You see, the Bible, in the very beginning.
In the beginning.
Right? It's like dark. You know, there's not even stars in the sky yet. And all of a sudden it says, in the beginning, right? God creates the heavens and the earth and the waters and the land and the birds and the fish and the animals on the land. And then he creates human. And he's like, man, Adam, you are fly. Oh, I'm good. But then in Genesis, the second chapter, verse number 18, God says, you know what? It is not good for man to be alone. But somewhere along the lines, we let pride get in the way. Well, I don't want to share the skeletons in my closet with anybody because they're going to judge me. Because I worked really hard to arrive at the position that I've arrived at, and if I was to talk it out with somebody else, they're going to know that I'm not who I've made myself out to be. But you see, Jesus talked about that. He says, don't judge. Because what you judge, you're going to be judged with. He says, you want to call out the speck in somebody else's eye? He takes it to the next level. He says, you got a beam hanging out of your eye. But somewhere we bought into it. We bought into the pride. We bought into the thought process. We bought into the tricks and the lies of the devil that we can't talk it out with somebody else to share what's going on in our lives. But you see, the Bible says that we are to bear one another's burdens. God did not create you to go through Christianity alone. He created you to do it with your brothers and sisters in Christ. As a matter of fact, in James, the 5th chapter, James says, you guys ought to confess your trespasses to one another. The New Living Translation says, confess your sins to one another. Have somebody that's gonna hold you accountable. Oh, but Pastor Luke, I ain't got nobody in my life. I'm all alone. Nobody wants to talk to me. Listen, there is somebody in your life right now. Somebody that when you talk to, whether it's your mama, Maybe it's your grandma. Maybe it's a cousin or a friend at work. When you talk to you don't feel like they're judging on you. You're just talking. When you talk, it seems like they just listen. It seems like they get you. That's a great person to start and share some of the things. Why? Because when you start to share what's on the inside of you, it's like a volcano that erupts. And all that built up pressure, all that magma, all that lava, boom, it's gone. And now there's this emptiness of peace, like, hey, I've done it. I've said it. The worst is over. I remember, listen, I'll be honest with you, I'll be real. I'm a man. And like 90% of Christians, statistically, I deal with men problems, or I dealt with men problems growing up, talking about purity. And I remember one day, everybody told me, hey, man, you're going to get married. It's all going to finish. It's going to be done. Amen. You got a wife. All that stuff goes. It didn't go away. And the pressure was building up, and the pressure was building up, and the pressure was building up until one day I finally mustered up the guts to tell my wife, babe, I got a problem, and I need your help. Instantly, boom, the pressure on the inside was gone. And now I had somebody that I wasn't worried about judging on me, wasn't worried about kicking me out, wasn't worried about all the things that the devil was telling me. Well, if you tell her, she's going to divorce you, and everybody's going to tell your business around the world, and everybody's going to have a, you know, looking at you thinking the same thing. No, when I told her, all of a sudden, I had a partner, somebody to hold me up, somebody say, we're going to get through this together. We're going to get on to the other side, and we're going to go beyond this little hang-up that you got. It's not a big deal in your life. See, God did not create you to bear your burdens by yourself. The Bible says to cast your cares on God, but also to talk to somebody else. And you've got somebody in your life, whether it's your mama, Pastor Luke, I can't talk to my mama. You've got to start talking to somebody. Let the pressure out. Talk it out. Talk it out with God. Talk it out with somebody else. Get it out. Have somebody that will hold you accountable in your life. How you doing? Well, to be honest with you, I have another scar. Well, let's get through it together. Talk it out with somebody else. You got to walk it out. How do you walk it out? You got to walk it out in the Word. Because you know what? In the process, in the walking through life, forgiving yourself, trying to let go of all the different things that hold you down, you got to walk it out in the Word. Why? Because we still live in an incentive-based system that every time you do bad, you're punished for it. Every time you do good, you're gonna do good. And the devil's not going to take it lying down. He's not going to stop trying to convince you that you're worthless, that you're no good, that there's no hope for you, that there's no future for you. You're not going to, the emotions that you have aren't going to go away. Sorry, God gave them to us. We are emotional creatures. Can I get an amen? I was talking to a friend of mine, and they were like, you know, one of those honest people that you go and talk to, and they were like, look, I'm just looking at you. And they're like, you are like way up here, and then you were like way down here. And you got to get yourself together and walk in the middle. And I'm like, you know me so well. To walk what the Word of God says, because the devil's going to keep telling you that you're worthless, that you're too far gone. Like Manasseh, your life is over, got the ring around your nose because the devil is dragging you to hell. But you know what? You start walking every day in the Word. You walk it out. Not what the devil says about you, not what your flesh says about you, not what your guilt and your anguish and your emotions say about you. Because God gave us emotions, and guilt is not a bad thing until you let it control you. To not walk out in your emotions, but rather to walk out in what the Word of God says. And every step you take, you are taking a journey towards forgiving yourself, towards letting the past go, and starting to head in the future of what God has for you. To walk it out. Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 1 says, let us, therefore, since we're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight, guilt, and sin which so easily ensnares us, and run the race of endurance. Which means every day you take a step in what the Word of God says. Not what your emotion says, not what your feeling says, not what the devil says, not what anybody else says about you, but what God says. I'm forgiven in the name of Jesus. That's not my past in the name of Jesus. That's not even me. I'm a new creation in the name of Jesus. All things have passed away in the name of Jesus. Like Romans the 8th chapter, verse number 1 says, I feel terrible about myself. But Paul the Apostle says, there is therefore no condemnation in Jesus for those who walk according to the Spirit of life. And I'm going to walk, and I'm going to take a step every day in what God has to say, and I'm going to walk out my forgiveness in God. and I'm going to speak it over my life. And forgiveness, forgiving yourself, is walking in the reality that you have already been forgiven by God himself. And if God can forgive you, why are you holding on to it? I'm just asking. So what happens to us in life is that we look at those things, we look at these problems, and we look at these scars, and we say, it's huge. I can't get over it. It's too big, Pastor Luke. Amen. They feel big. I'm a big hiker. I do that all the time. I've talked about backpacking and hiking all the time. You know, when you're standing at the summit or the base of a mountain, and you're looking at a massive mountain, it's huge. When you're looking at several thousand feet of elevation gain, it's a challenge. It's a journey. I know I got my buddy Antonio on the front row. We hiked Mount Whitney, 14,500 feet. We hiked. Tallest mountain in the continental United States. It was a big, stinking mountain with a 2,000-foot drop-off on one side. Scary. But a couple of months ago, I flew to Washington. And when I flew to Washington, cruising at an altitude of 30,000 feet, that big old mountain that seemed like a big old mountain that seemed like I couldn't do it, it wasn't as big. You look at the scope of the Sierra Nevada mountains, you're like, where's Mount Whitney? I don't even see it. Can't even see it. Is that one? No, that's not it. No, is that that one? No, it's not that one. Oh, that's Lake Tahoe. Man, I missed it. I didn't even see it. And you know what's even better? That's 30,000 feet. When you look at Earth from the moon, there's not even mountains. It's a big, smooth ball. And when we walk out, what we're doing is we're saying, I'm not going to walk life in my perspective. Because my perspective says that this scar, this issue, this sin, this thing that I'm holding on to, it's too big to get over. But I'm going to start walking in God's perspective. I'll start walking at 30,000 feet, looking down at that. All right, you know what? It's not that big. It's a bump. And then as I walk at 30,000 feet, I'm going to keep elevating. I'm going to keep going. And finally, I'm going to start to see that little scar, well, for what it is, like what God sees it as, a big, smooth ball. There's not even a bump on the earth when you look at it from the moon. And that's God's perspective. To realize that we can walk this out, that we can do this. So in retrospect and conclusion tonight, you can let go of the sin and the weight that ensnares you. To learn to forgive yourself. How? By operating and walking out the forgiveness that God has given to you through Jesus Christ, through repentance, through taking the journey, by talking it out with God and saying, God, no longer am I going to go this way. God, I'm going to go to you because it's for real and I really want to make a change in my life. And God's going to say, I'm going to take you on a journey. Follow me, child. To talk it out with somebody else so that you're not bearing the weight of the sin and the shame that you have in your life, but rather you've got somebody that's going to come alongside of you and lift up and come up underneath your arm and say, hey, I got you. Let's do this together. We can get through this together somewhere in life. And to start walking it out. Your emotions are going to tell you you're worthless. The devil's going to tell you all day, every minute of your life, you are a sinner. But the grace of God and the word of God and the path of God says, no, you're going to take a higher path. You're not going to look at that mountain from the base of it. You're going to look at that mountain from space. And you're going to see that it's not as big as you think it is. And you're going to live life according to what I want you to do, to walk out our life, to walk it out with God. And it starts by being open and honest with God. By saying, God, what is it in my life? There's things in my life. Sometimes, you know, we're afraid of talking it out. We're afraid of going to God. We're afraid of going to somebody else. Maybe we've even bought into the lie that, you know what, if I can keep my skeleton in my closet long enough, God won't see it. The devil likes to tell us that. I mean, think about Adam and Eve. They realized that they were naked and they hid. And God was like, hey, where are you at? And they're like, oh, we were naked and we hid from you. Like God didn't know where they were. Like we buy into the lie that God didn't know that we have skeletons in the closet. That we have scars that we're trying to be like, no, that's a secret. I cover it up. No, God knows. As a matter of fact, God's got a plan for those scars. God's got a destiny for those scars. In Luke, the 7th chapter, the Bible tells us that Jesus went to a Pharisee's house to have dinner. And at this Pharisee's house, this woman comes in. And the Bible says she was a sinner. All right, so just think about when the Bible says this lady was a sinner, all right? She was not a reputable woman. She comes into this Pharisee's house. She breaks open a perfume box and she anoints Jesus' feet and she washes Jesus' feet. And the Bible said the Pharisee was just thinking in his head. He wasn't even talking about it. He was just like, man, this woman, washing Jesus' feet. And Jesus knows what he's thinking. He says, man, why you got a problem with this? When I walked into the house, you didn't wash my feet. And here she is, she's washing my feet with her tears and drying them with her hair. And he begins to talk about this woman. And look what he says in Luke, the 7th chapter. Luke, the 7th chapter, verse number 47, talking about this woman. He says, therefore, I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven because she loved much. To whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. Some of you, you've got some deep scars that you've done to yourself. Committed some horrible things, some atrocities, and the Bible might even call them abominations. But the Bible says, to whom is forgiven much, loves much. Do you remember how I said we would talk about the power of forgiveness? Jesus just said it here. Her sins are forgiven. Why? For she loved much. You see, forgiven much equals much love. God's got a plan for your past. He's got a plan for your scars. He says, I'm going to forgive them and I'm going to turn around. And they're not going to be something that holds you back. They're going to be something that propels you into the future. Why? Because now you've got love, the greatest force on earth, operating on your side. Paul says, if I had nothing else but love, I would change the world. He says, you got to operate in faith, hope, and love. And he says, the greatest of these is love. And Jesus says to the lady who was a sinner, because you have been forgiven of much, you love much. You see, you can love others again, and you can love yourself again. Why? Because God Almighty has forgiven you of much. And because of that forgiveness, now you can walk in the love of God Almighty and begin to share the love of Jesus Christ in a lost and dying world. There is power in forgiveness, the greatest power on earth in forgiveness, the power of love. It starts by recognizing you're not too far gone. Don't let the devil beat you up anymore. Talk it out with God. Talk it out with somebody. Share. Get the load off your chest and walk it out every day in God's plan and God's will for your life. Did you guys get something out of the word this evening? Next week, we're going to talk about the all-important subject, dun, 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 of forgiving others. You're like, Pastor Luke, I got an appointment next week. I don't know. Talk about those scars. Amen. We can do this to get through and to walk in the reality that we are forgiven by God Almighty. You know, today as we talked about scars, as we talked about sin, as we talked about snares and things that hold us back and the lies that the devil feeds us and the lies that we feed ourselves, maybe there are those of you in this place today that you are feeling that conviction on the inside. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit will convict the world. Sin. He's going to let you know why. He's going to let you know not to condemn you. Jesus says, I did not come into this world that it might be condemned, but I came into this world that it might be saved. And see, the moment, the glorious moment in which God makes us aware of the scars that we might have been blind to is the very opportunity to walk in the reality that we are forgiven of God, of our sins and our scars by Jesus Christ. But that moment doesn't come because of a pretense of thought, because of a hope or a thought or a religious ceremony. That reality of forgiveness and of operation and living in what God says about me doesn't come because I sit and I hear the pastor preach on a Wednesday night, or I sing some songs, or I listen to Air One on my way to work. That doesn't come because I was baptized as a child in a ceremonial ritual, or because I went to Sabbath or catechism classes. It doesn't come because my parents told me that I was a Christian, and because I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything else doesn't mean that I must be saved or I must be a Christian. It doesn't come because of those ways. It doesn't even come because you have a heightened awareness of spirituality. Pastor Luke, I'm a spiritual person and I'm open. Open your heart to the call of God, because Jesus says nobody comes to the Father unless he is drawn. And I believe right now that the Spirit of God is speaking to you. I believe that the Holy Spirit right now is speaking to you, saying, child, you've got enough self-inflicted wounds in your life, and it's time for you to accept my forgiveness, to accept my love, to accept my purpose in your life, and to stop doing life your way and to start doing life my way, the right way, the real way. You see, Jesus says it like this. He says, the thief doesn't come but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. They're not knocking on your door to benefit your life. They're coming to take all your stuff. And he says, the devil is coming after you to steal, to kill, and to destroy your life. But Jesus says that I might come. I have come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. And the only way we can accept that life through Jesus Christ is to do it God's way. Jesus says that I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, and no one goes to the Father except through him. And what Jesus says in John, the third chapter, to a religious man, a man who thought he was doing everything right, a man according to the sacrificial law and the ceremonial law, was upholding everything that he needed to do in order to be righteous in the eyes of God. And you would have think Jesus would have said, man, you just keep doing all the actions that you're doing. Keep going to church like you're going to. Keep saying the confessions over yourself that you're saying. But Jesus says these words. He says that you must be born again. What does that mean, born again? From the beginning of God's word to the end of God's word, it's always meant the same thing in the heart of God. It means that you've given God all of your heart. You've given him all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. You see, the forgiveness of your sins doesn't come because of a confession to a person in a box. It doesn't come because of a willful thought. The forgiveness of your sins, the conviction of your sins that the Holy Spirit puts upon you, the awareness that you need something comes so that you might accept the invitation of Jesus Christ to come into your life and to be the Lord and Savior of your life. Jesus says in the book of Revelation, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And he says, if anybody opens the door, I'll come and I'll dine with him. And they'll dine with me and we'll be together. See, Jesus says, I'm giving you the invitation today. I'm knocking. The Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart right now. And if you begin to open your heart, open your eyes to the call of God, you can sense that right now that God is speaking to you through his Holy Spirit saying, it's time for you to come home. You've got scars, but don't let them define you. You've got self-inflicted wounds, but don't let them deter you, because God says, I want to take those scars like the woman who had much sin, and I want to turn them around and propel you into a life of promise, a life of prominence, a life of fulfillment, and a life of reason. But it comes by accepting Jesus into your heart and into your life as your Lord and Savior. Jesus says these words. He says that if you accept him before men, he'll accept you or acknowledge you before his Father. He says, but if you deny him before men, he'll deny you before his Father. Today, I want to give you that opportunity. In a moment, we're going to change destinies together. And it starts by making a decision to say, I feel the call of God on my life, and I'm going to respond today. A response to God's call. In a moment, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. When I smack my hands together real loud, bang. If that's you in this place today and you sense the draw of the Holy Spirit and you say, Pastor Luke, that's me. I've got scars and I felt like I was worthless. I felt like I was hopeless. I felt like I was too far gone. I felt like, you know, I'm wrapped up in this repetitive cycle of sin that I just can't seem to get out of. It's time to go before God with a genuine heart and bring it to God. And we're going to do that today by giving Jesus your heart and giving him your life. So when I count to three, bang! I ask you to do something real bold, and I'm asking you to make a decision to respond to the call of the Holy Spirit on your life by raising your hand. You see, what you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God my heart. I want to give God my life. I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it, put it right back down. I'm not going to embarrass you. I'm here to support you, to build you up, and to encourage you through this life that God has destined for you in Jesus Christ. And this is the best moment of your life. You see, you've had doctors and dentist appointments. Today, you're here for a divine appointment. Between you and God, the Holy Spirit is speaking to you right now, drawing you into this place, saying, it's time to come home. It's time to accept life. And today it starts by responding to that call. Oh, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. Put it right back down. And we'll follow through together right after that. But make that first decision today. Who should raise your hands if you've never given your heart? You've never given your life to Jesus. If that's you, in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child, but you just kind of feel disconnected or unsettled. Listen, God does not want you to walk around your life groping in the darkness, hoping that you're going to make it. God says, no, I want you to know. And he's got a destiny and a plan for you. If you don't know that, if you haven't accepted that and you're not walking in it, listen, today's the day for you to walk in that and make sure in your life. If you've been living lukewarm, what does that mean? Not hot, you're not cold, you're not in, you're not out, kind of occasional church attendance, doing your own thing, doing some of God's thing. If that's you in this place today, if that's you, in a moment, get ready and you can pop your hand up. I'll see it, I'll acknowledge you, and put it right back down. And we'll follow through tonight together, changing destinies forever, accepting the forgiveness of Jesus Christ in your life so that you can begin to walk in the forgiveness of your life. It starts today by responding to that call. So I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you in this place, you get ready. You pop your hand up, I'll see it, I'll acknowledge it, and we'll put it right back down, and we'll go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. Say, I want to give my heart. I want to give my life. One, two, three, four. I see you right over there. Four wise people. Danny's pointing over in this direction. Five, I got you right over there in the back. Six, I got you right over there. Seven, I see you right over there. Seven wise people. Anybody else in this place? Say, man, I wonder if I should. Spirit of God speaking to you. That's you in this place. Anybody else today? Seven wise people. I see you back over there. Eight. Where are you at, number nine? Where are you at, number 10? The Spirit of God speaking to you, saying, come on, this is you, rooting you on. It's your time. It's your moment. Respond to God today. We're going to change destinies in just a moment by praying together, and I want to include you in that. Anybody else in this place today? Eight wise people. Anybody else? Number nine, number 10? Scratch your head. I'm going to count you. All right. Well, praise God for eight wise people. Amen. That's great. So, all eight of you, a couple of you guys over here, a couple of you over here, over there in the back, over here as well, all eight of you, or maybe you're number nine, maybe you're number 10, you say, man, I didn't raise my hand, I kind of chickened out, but I know the Spirit of God's speaking to you. You don't get saved because you raise your hand. Remember, I said you're responding, you're making a decision. We know this. This is logic 101, okay? Every decision you make requires action. Otherwise, nothing happens. And so often we get so wrapped up in, oh, I raised my hand in a church service, that means everything's good. No, we're going to change destinies together, and we're going to do that right here, right now. So I want to encourage you in a moment. We're all going to stand, and as we do, my buddy Cameron's going to sing. Cameron's going to sing. All right. Cameron's going to sing. And as we do, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible, a friend, if you need a friend, get out of your chair, get out of the aisle, get into the aisle, and I want you to come meet me right here at this altar, and we're going to change destinies together. So if you raised your hand, or maybe you should have raised your hand, come on, get out of your seat, come meet me right here. Let's follow through with that decision and change destinies together right now. Guys, you came. A couple of things I want to tell you. You're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday celebration. The Spirit of God speaking to you, say, you know what? Yeah, I got these things going on the inside of me, but you know what God's going to say? God's saying right now, we're going to go through this. We're going to forgive you. That God says, I'm going to wipe that all clean. You're going to start brand new, born again today, the first day of the rest of your life. You know, the Bible says that heaven is celebrating, having a party on your behalf right now. So here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here? His name's Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel's a really neat guy. He's going to do a couple of things with you. He's going to take you guys right over there. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved because you invited Jesus into your heart and your life. You're going to do that today, make him the Lord and Savior. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that. You're going to invite him to be the leader of your life. He's going to give you some free information, some free literature to help you get yourself on the right path, set one foot, like we talked about, walk in the Word of God. He's going to help you, point you in the right direction of what direction, what the Word of God says to walk in. The other thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back, hang out with us. We want to connect you with a friend here at church. Somebody they'll buy you a cup of coffee, meet with you in our cafe, get you a soda, sit down with you, teach you some things about the Word of God for a couple of weeks to get you strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel. Amen.